Good afternoon to everyone. Let me please introduce myself and my colleagues. My name is German Cobo. I came from the Open University of Catalonia, which is located in Barcelona, in Spain. We work more specifically at the Informatics, Multimedia and Telecommunications Department. We are teachers of the Telecommunications Engineering degree and master. This is the index of the presentation. First, I'm going to explain to you just the main highlights of our educational model. We are a distance education university, and the most part of our students are adult learners. So the center of our teaching learning process is our virtual campus, which is a web-based environment where both teachers and learners can access to the virtual classrooms or their subjects and among other things. The assessment of our learning process is mostly based on continuous assessment tests that learners deliver throughout the whole semester. There are subjects with a final test at the end of the semester, but the most part of the assessment process is based on continuous assessment. And finally, our model is asynchronous, which means that teachers and learners don't have to be necessarily working at the same time. So this is the key point of my presentation, because in order to perform that model, our virtual classrooms provide with asynchronous communication tools, being the most common of these tools, the online discussion forums. So in this scenario, monitoring, guidance and feedback maybe can be difficult and very time consuming task for us, for the teachers, especially when you have like 60, 70 or even more students in your per virtual classroom. So we consider that the activity carried out by learners in the discussion threads can be a relevant source of indicators for us, for the teachers, in order to facilitate our tasks. So in the present work, we proposed an analysis strategy in order to identify participation profiles, the participation profiles adopted by our learners in online discussion forums. So on this area, you can find interesting contributions in the literature. From a more theoretical perspective, working, lurking and shirking are considered the most general behaviors that you can find in an online discussion forum. This is defined like this regarding the two main activities that can be carried out in the forums, which are reading and writing, reading posts and writing posts. So the thing is that the workers are like visible students, both for the other students and teachers, but lurkers and shirkers are invisible students due to the nature of their activity. So from another perspective, from the social network analysis perspective, it's interesting how the interactions between learners, between users, can be analyzed and shown in order to evaluate the level of participation. It's interesting the parameters that you can use in order to characterize the learner's activity, parameters like the depth of the threads, the reciprocal readings, amount of cross replies, and things like that. And also you can find another contributions that analyze the activity carried out in forums, but in forums of general topic, not strictly educational forums. For instance, the work of Chan et al. From 2010 defined clusters of users in order to classify forums of different topics regarding their predominant user roles. They define user roles like popular initiators, popular participants, supporters, etc. So our goal is to identify participation profiles by finding learners with similar activity patterns, since clustering learners has proved to be a proper way to find similar learning behaviors. In our case, we a priori don't want to impose a number of activity patterns, because we don't know what's the number. So we use an agglomerative hierarchical clustering algorithm in order to try to automatically find the number of patterns, which is the number of relevant activity patterns in our forums. So we propose a two-stage analysis strategy. In the first stage, the learner's activity is characterized in two domains, the writing domain and the reading domain. And then learners with similar activity patterns are grouped together in each domain separately by using our clustering algorithm. And in the second stage, learners belonging to the same clusters in both domains are grouped together. So we obtain a new set of clusters that allow us to identify the participation profiles. So this is the typical configuration of an agglomerative hierarchical clustering algorithm. You need no initialization of the algorithm in terms of number of clusters. You know a priori number of clusters, you don't need to set that parameter. Ah, I'm sorry. Okay. You have to decide the metrics of your algorithm and the linkage function. The linkage function is how you decide to the way you decide the distance between two clusters. The most commonly used linkage functions are the single linkage and the complete linkage, which leads to the nearest neighbor algorithm and the farthest neighbor algorithm. Then the outcome of the algorithm is not a final partition for the data, but a graph, a dendrogram type graph, which is which has a richer information than a single partition of the data, because you can see the structure of the elements in your data set. And of course, you by cutting or processing the dendrogram, you can find a final partition of your data. The thing is that the most common ways to cut the dendrogram or process the dendrogram in order to find the data, the final partition, you need to manually set any kind of threshold or parameters. So this is this can be a problem when you don't have an external labeling or a partition of your data set in order to compare your performance and see if your thresholds are proper or not. So in order to explain our clustering algorithm, let me show you this. This is just an example, a synthetic data set where you can find four natural clusters. So using an Euclidean distance matrix and a single linkage function, you can find that this is the dendrogram to that data set. Here you can find the four clusters in your data set. So by taking this dendrogram, for instance, and setting an horizontal cut, setting a height threshold to cut the dendrogram, you can obtain a number of clusters. But if you take a look at this dendrogram, there's no possible horizontal cut for you to recover the four original clusters in your dataset. So this is not enough. We need something more interesting. One possibility is to calculate the inconsistency of the links of the dendrogram by taking the Sun's proposal of the calculation of this inconsistency. So you can dismiss the most inconsistent links in the dendrogram by setting an inconsistency threshold. In that way, you can perform a cut like that, and you can obtain the original, in that example, you can obtain the original clusters in your dataset. That's cool, that's better than the first option, but the thing is that you have to manually set a threshold. And a priori, you don't know if this threshold or another threshold is the best threshold that you can set. So what we propose is the following: to calculate not the inconsistency of the links, but the consistency of the links inside the dendrogram. We propose this equation to calculate the consistency of the links, which is the standard score of the gap above the link out of the gaps below the link, with two correction terms. Then what we do is we build the whole dendrogram and we calculate the consistency of all the clusters in the dendrogram. Then we select the more consistent cluster, and what we do is to isolate this cluster from the rest of the data and get the rest of the data and complete again the dendrogram. And then we repeat the process. We select the most consistent cluster of the remaining dendrogram, then we isolate it, and we rebuild again. By repeating this process, we can isolate the four original clusters in the dataset without having to set manually any threshold or any parameter, any threshold. So what we have done in this work is to apply this clustering algorithm, this strategy, in the following experiment. We have taken three subjects for line telecommunications engineering degree, which are electronic circuits, linear systems theory, and mathematics. And three complete semesters, from February 2009 to July 2010. The total amount of students are 672 students, 8 virtual classrooms, and 3,842 posts in the discussion forums of the virtual classrooms. The participation of learners in discussion boards was not mandatory in these subjects, but strongly recommended. So regarding the three complete semesters, the final withdrawal rate was the 36%, and the total passing rate was the 52%. Then, taking this data, we have characterized the activity of the students in the writing domain by using these four parameters here, which are the depth of the threads initiated by learner, the ratio of reply posts written by learner, the ratio of learners replied by learner, and the writing rhythm. In the same way, we define four reading parameters to represent the activity of the students in the reading domain, which are the ratio of posts read by learner, the ratio of threads where learner reads at least one post, the ratio of learners read by learner, and the reading rhythm. So, in the first stage of the analysis, we obtained two dendrograms, one for the writing domain and the other one for the reading domain. In the writing domain, we have found three different clusters, in the reading domain, five different clusters. By observing the values of the parameters of the elements of the learners within each cluster, we can put a label to the cluster. So, for instance, in the first writing cluster, contains all the learners all the students that have written not a single post in the whole semester. And, for example, the third writing cluster contains the students that have a higher writing activity during the whole semester. So, then in the second stage, by joining together the students that are clustered in the same writing cluster and in the same reading cluster, we obtain a final set of clusters, which you can see the final set of clusters at the left side of this table. At the right side of the table, you can see the participation profiles that we have obtained from the final set of clusters. You can see also the ratio of students in each cluster, the withdrawal ratio in each cluster, the passing ratio, in each cluster, and the average representative, the centroid, of each cluster. And you can see the values of the eight four writing and four reading parameters that we have used. So regarding this table, there are many interesting things that we can see. For example, the differences between the two levels of lurking that we have found in terms of the reading activity in the four reading parameters. In the same way, you can see the differences between the three levels of working that we have found regarding the writing parameters and the reading parameters to make the difference between the high-level and mid-level workers in writing terms and the mid-level workers and low-level workers in reading terms. And, of course, also you can take a look at the passing rates, the participation profiles with... the highest passing rates are the high and mid-level workers and the high-level workers. And the highest withdrawal rates we can find at the low-level workers, and of course at the Shirker's participation profile. As a conclusion, the proposed two-stage analysis strategy has proved to be suitable to find different patterns of writing and reading activity, and to, in the second stage, identify different participation profiles in our forums. Besides, different kinds of working and lurking have been identified both in terms of level of activity and final performance. And finally, as further work, we plan to increase the number of domains at the first analysis stage, and study the impact of this increasing in terms of the obtained participation profiles. Besides, we are currently working in a new version of the hierarchical algorithm, which we hope we'll be able to handle with more kinds of data and clustering situations. And that was it.
Any questions for Carmen?
How quickly can you start doing the clustering analysis after people start working like, in the environment?
after people start working?
Yeah, I mean, like, how? When do you? When can you start clustering people?
In that experiment here, we consider the whole semester.
Right. So it's not until after the whole semester that you.
You can start. Right. You can take, for instance, the first week of work in the semester, and then you can.
You can try again, of course.
Yeah.
Did you do any sort of difference analysis between the early work and the?
No, that's a good one. Right. No, but we plan also to try to build some kind of predictor from this data. So we are interested in the as soon as possible predictor.
Right.
So the idea, I suppose, will be to run this modeling process by taking, I don't know, the first week, the second week, the third week of the semester, and then see, then we will see when the participation profiles that we obtain arrive to, I don't know, to a unstable condition, and then you will be able to like make predictions or something. Yeah.
Then the fun question: can you find the trolls?
Find what?
The trolls.
The trolls.
Yes, the trollers.
I don't know what
the
trolls.
The people that come in and write the bad things.
Yeah, if you analyze the content of the message, yeah, but that's not the case.
Hi. So this is very interesting work, and it's actually quite similar to what we're doing in our research group, though looking in a very different context.
Mm-hmm.
And so looking at it, I guess I had two questions. One of the things that we've found when we've been running cluster analysis of various variables of how students participate in discussions is that a lot of their activity is not different just in quantity. So you have everything kind of as higher and lower level, but in terms of quality. And I don't mean a qualitative analysis, but the difference in what, for example, the breadth of the messages they read versus the depth actually is showing different understandings of what they are expecting to get out of a discussion, what they see as their purpose for participation. So I was curious what the framing of the purpose, you said it was recommended but not mandatory, but what are they thinking they're getting out of it? And have you thought about examining potentially these clusters as indications of different ways of approaching discussions, not just as higher or lower?
We take higher and lower because regarding the centroids, we saw that the level of activity was highly different between one final cluster and another. Taking other parameters like the length of the messages or something like that, we haven't done that because we have no access in an automatic process to the content of the messages, so we can process this content. So we chose those parameters because we found it interesting, especially from the social network analysis perspective. But yeah, I agree with you that it would be interesting to add more like qualitative parameters to the analysis. Yeah, it's true.
Yeah, also I would just say that some of the stuff we've been able to do is if you look at the different quantitative parameters that you can calculate automatically, some of them might be indicating different things. For example,
yeah,
we found people who read quite broadly but not deeply, and those who read deeply but not broadly. So even though both of the numbers are higher or lower, we might interpret them in different ways. So I think I didn't get to quite a good enough look at those numbers, but there might be something interesting in there.
Yeah, thanks.
I actually have two real quick ones. One, I'm kind of curious why you consider this an experiment.
Why we consider this an experiment?
What?
Why we consider this an experiment? You mean?
Yes.
Well, an experiment an experiment. We got this data. I mean, we can.
But I mean, you weren't manipulating anything. So I mean, I'm just kind of curious about your use of the word experiment. The second thing, actually touched on the highly recommended but not required. And I'm wondering to what extent you think how much measurement error is creeping into your work when you're doing this classification, when you're recommending people do something but not requiring that they do it.
You mean the not mandatory using, yeah. It's not mandatory, but due to the nature of the three subjects, we, the teachers, we propose activities at the online discussion forums, and students ask questions and answer the questions. It's not mandatory to do that, but if you don't do that, you are missing, from the student perspective, you are missing the point. You are missing the richer information in your classroom. So it's not mandatory, but people that don't do that, they usually fail the subject.
See, I would consider it more of an experiment if with one group you recommended it, with another you highly recommended it, and then with a third group you required it, and then looking at how the clustering algorithm worked for those three different, in those three different cases. That's what I guess I was driving at when I used the word experiment.
Okay. I consider that an experiment because, I don't know, we choose these three subjects in these two semesters, but we have more subjects. I mean, you can repeat the experiment with other subjects or other semesters. That's the only reason.
All right. Thank you, Herman.